Rather than use existing sets, the filmmakers decided to build the Hill Valley of 1885 from scratch.
When it's dressed in their horses and wagons there, and, you know, people walking around with gun belts on, it really feels like you step back in time.
And action!
They just don't build sets like this. It was so incredibly detailed and thorough and well thought out that it was an incredible thrill to actually hear, you know, like, rolling, action, and, like, stepping out in the street with my six-shooter, you know? But it was pretty wild.
Just tell me one thing. Where'd you learn to shoot like that?
7-Eleven.
Come along with me, celebrate year three. It's Marchy McFly again. Back to the Future 3, a month-long podcast with me. It's Marchy McFly. It's Marchy McFly again. I'm doing it again. I couldn't stay away, I confess. Another adventure with Marty and Doc, and this time they're in the OS. So come along with me, celebrate year three. It's Marchy McFly again. Stay here all month long and get sick of this song, 'cause it's Marchy McFly, it's Marchy McFly again. It's a 31-day podcast where I celebrate one movie, and the movie happens to be Back to the Future Part 3.
Friiiiiday, March 10th. Didn't I already sing this song the same way just a couple days ago? Hello, everybody, and welcome back to Marchy McFly. It's March 10th, which means for the 10th day in a row, I watched Back to the Future Part 3. And for the 10th day in a row, I am here podcasting about Back to the Future, Part 3. It's early on Friday. In fact, it's early because I have the day off today. I've mentioned this before. It is a holiday at my work. They give us extra days during the spring break. I'm not down in Cancun partying it up with all the youths. No, I'm on my kitchen chair, finishing my breakfast, talking about Back to the Future, Part 3. Today, I want to kind of focus on Hill Valley. You know, Hill Valley plays such a crucial part in all the Back to the Future movies. Everything they do, as far as changing history, it all revolves around one city, Hill Valley, California. In fact, they never, ever leave Hill Valley. From the 80s was such a personal story, the first one, going from 80s to the 50s. It was specific to Marty and his parents. The second movie, even though we went from Hill Valley left and right, it, north, left and right, future and past and alternative timelines, it still was Hill Valley, even though Hill Valley had become a hub of debauchery, thanks to Biff Tannen. And going back 100 years before that, in 1885, Hill Valley was the really, it seemed like it was becoming a major part of California. It had a town. It was right on the railroad, which I think helped. We helped with all kinds. I'm sure all kinds of towns popped up once the railroad was available. And going through, California. I'm always wondering, how do they get that so level? How is that perfectly level back in the 1800s? I mean, to me, I just think it's a feat of of superior ingenuity and engineering, and I'm sure it was at the time, but even looking at it now, I'm thinking, wow, that is pretty amazing when you think about it. The ability to travel long distances and just hanging out in the car. You know, the guy selling the barbed wire, he looked like he was ready for just a nice, relaxing ride to San Francisco, which I assume is north of Hill Valley. I really have no idea. But I want to talk about kind of Marty leaving, you know, having to walk from the McFly farm all the way into Hill Valley. I think in the book, in the novelization, it says it was 6 miles. He drove, I think it was longer. I think they, in the book it said it was 15 miles or something like that. But Seamus rode him out to the railroad tracks, and then that allowed him to walk the rest of the way. I don't know why Seamus didn't want to bring him the rest of the way, probably because they didn't want to have to invest on you know, double shots of Michael J. Fox. But much like in the first movie, he gets, you know, he looks at the newspaper, 1955. You can hear, I wonder if you can hear my dog crying in the background. I'm going to take you out in a second, and then through the power of editing, I will be back. But 1955, he looks at the newspaper, and he's looking around Hill Valley. 2015, the future, he's looking around Hill Valley. And once again, in 1885, he is looking around Hill Valley. I tried to stop the video as much as I possibly could to take notes to everything. I'm coming, honey, I'm coming, to take notes to everything I could see in Hill Valley, all the shops in the background. So I want to go through what I think I saw, and I think I caught a lot of it. Then I want to go to the Futurepedia to compare and contrast and see if I missed anything, or if I you know, wrote down anything, if I got anything wrong. So I'm going to be doing that right after I take my dog out. I shouldn't even have told you, because it's going to be like, it's so seamless, you're not even going to notice that I took my dog out, and all of a sudden I'm back here talking to you about Back to the Future Part 3. Seamless! Oh my gosh, you have no idea the 10 minutes just went by. So, what was I talking about? Oh, Back to the Future Part 3. Marty goes into town, and right away he's just walking up and down the street. Now in 55... he probably looked out of place because of the life preserver that he was wearing, the vest. In 2015, he was wearing Marty Jr.'s outfit, even though I guess pulling the pockets out made the pants look like they were inside out. Nobody noticed the back pockets. Nobody noticed him. In fact, they just assumed he was Marty Jr. But in 1885, everybody's staring at him, or mostly everybody, because he's dressed like Roy Rogers, you know, in some sort of musical Western. But what we see in 1885, so this is what I have listed down, 1885 Hill Valley. The first sign we see is for Joe Statler. We talked about him, Honest Joe Statler. He sells horses. Now, obviously, in 1985, Statler Toyota is where Marty gets his truck, and probably where most of the Hill Valley Toyota drivers get their cars. We see a sign for a bathhouse and a barber. We see a couple, like a guy taking a bath. We see a couple guys sweeping up. In the background, I had to freeze this one, we see, I think it says fortunes told for 50 cents. So there's a fortune teller in town. I'm surprised we didn't go there, and it would have been fun to see her, like the woman go, oh, you're not from around here, are you? You should be in the Alamo, in the basement. We see a sign. We see a meat market butcher. The guy's chopping up. I think we see rabbits hanging. He's chopping up some animals. I see another saloon way off in the distance, but that saloon doesn't even come close to the saloon hotel where it seems like most of the town goes. I see a sign for a dressmaker, a doctor, a general store. The general store, I think, said, that's also where they had boots and hats, or boots and shoes, cigars also. Then we see the sign hanging up over the road. It says Hill Valley Festival, dance, food, games, Saturday night, September 5th, proceeds to construct the clock tower. We see a sign for T.V. Livingston Cabinet Maker. Now, I know... T.L. Livingston, cabinet maker. We know Joe Statler is a name from 1985. I don't know about Livingston. I'd have to double check that. We see the Undertaker, of course, the undertaking sign, and we know the Undertaker later is measuring Marty for his suit and for his coffin. Or actually, he just checks him for the suit, measures him for the coffin. We see, of course, A. Jones, manure. Yes, the Jones family has been shoveling shit for at least 70 years in Hill Valley. I don't know if they're in 1985. I don't remember there needing to be like manure companies in the 80s. See a sign for a shoe shop that might be part of the general store. I'm not sure. Then we see in the background Gafez Cigars. I think it says G-A-G-H-A apostrophe S F-E-E-S-S. Fees. Gafez Cigars. Tobacco. Boots and shoes. We see a sign for the marshal's office. It says the marshal went to Hayesville for the hanging of Stinky Lomax. Now, Stinky Lomax is a fantastic name. And it's funny, I looked it up, and like someone on Twitter did take the name Stinky Lomax, a username. Fantastic. It's a good username, and it's a nice little like Easter egg for Back to the Future fans that you, not a name that would stick out, but it is a name that like you'd be like, oh, that's what that's from. It's a nice reference. And also it makes sense that the marshal and his group were out of town, because that would allow Buford to run wild and hang Clint Eastwood in. Why am I adding R's? Clint Eastwood at the courthouse. We got ourselves a courthouse. About time we have ourselves a hanging. We see a sign for something real, Wells Fargo, in the background. Of course, the Wells Fargo wagon goes by Marty, almost runs him over. It doesn't slow down at all. And then how Marty lands in the horse manure, which I'm sure the Jones family will be there to scoop up pretty quick. Marty's shoes must stink, but I feel like everything stinks. So when he goes into the saloon, nobody notices, because there's guys, these guys probably haven't bathed in a while. There's a dude spitting his chew right out on the floor. Okay, what are you doing? My dog is like, I took her out. I gave her some treats. Now she's right at my feet. And now she's got her paws up on the chair. Like she's up on up on her hind legs, but her front paws are on me, and I'm rubbing her. What do you want? I'm talking Back to the Future Part 3. We talked about this. Seamless. Nothing more seamless than one moment I'm inside with my dog, next moment I'm outside by myself. Listen to the crunch of snow. I'm in the yard. It's actually a really nice day out. The sun is blazing, but I am wearing some light gloves and a winter hat. And here's the thing. I can't just be like, I'm recording my podcast. You know, the way my house is set up, my computer is in my recording equipment. Everything is right at the kitchen table. Well, I can't be like, can you skip a meal so that I can finish recording my podcast? And can you stop the dog from being a dog so I can finish recording my daily podcast just think about that in the middle of the day. It's not at night. I'm not in my office, nothing like that. I'm just middle of the morning, early. And I'm thinking, can I just please continue talking about Back to the Future 3 for the 10th day in a row? And the answer is I probably could, but I don't want to wait. And I couldn't, because it's rude. It's rude. And I say, you know what? I know. It's me. It's me. I'm the problem. It's me. I understand. It's very silly to be like, I'm recording my podcast, which is why I'm going to take my recorder. I'm going to go outside. And I clip my lapel mic to my sweatshirt. So when my head goes down, it sounds really good. When I'm up here, it still sounds pretty good. So where was I talking about? Oh, yeah. The marshal went to go hang Stinky Lomax. God, may God have mercy on Stinky Lomax's soul. I wonder what he did. And he had to go to Hayesville to witness it. So it wasn't a crime he committed in Hill Valley. I would have liked to learn more about that. And I wonder if there are any expanded universe comic books or anything to touch on the Stinky Lomax. I mentioned the Wells Fargo and the clock tower. Oh, the Wells Fargo company, of course, that being a real thing, and the wagon, and of course the manure that Marty stepped in. The big thing is seeing the clock tower inside, being built. The clock tower that is so iconic. I've mentioned it before. so iconic. It's iconic in first of all on the Universal lot, just as part of the Universal, filming location studios. But it's also it's majorly iconic for Back to the Future. Never mind that it's used in other movies, and you can probably see it in Gremlins. It's really a Back to the Future first kind of icon, and we see it being built. So, and I love it. It's like, this is not CGI stuff. So either, like, it looks like most of the stuff is being built. And I think in that video with the Kook Kirk Cameron, or actually it was another video where they talked about, you know, Hill Valley wasn't like a set that was used already. It wasn't an old Western set. I believe they built most of it, you know, for this movie specifically, which is probably where, like, a lot of the budget goes. When you think about it, they had to do that for 55, and to a degree they had to do it for 2015. I mean, there's, I'm sure a lot of it could have been, was, you know, special effects, but still, this is 1989 special effects, so it ain't the CG that we know today, where everything could just be put there and look pretty realistic. So we also see, I see a sign for the Hill Valley Telegraph, the newspaper in the background. I see a sign for Stetson. Now they make hats, right? I think Stetson is a hat, not a cologne, right? Isn't Stetson a cologne too? I don't know. I see a sign for Hut Baths, but that's part of the main saloon and hotel. Of course, we see a sign for livery and feed stable, but that is Doc's place. That's where the local blacksmith does, you know, his work, whatever that is. And I see a sign for a ladder company, and I see a sign for something called W.J. Chang. That is all. That's all, everything that I saw. And now I'd like to pull up the 1885 Futurepedia page at backtothefuture.fandom.com. I'll put a link to this in the show notes to this page. It talks about 1885 was a full century before the modern time of Marty McFly in 1985. The town consisted of two major dirt streets which intersected at the Courthouse Square. Because you did see at the courthouse, you could take a left, and there's more roads going there. If you're facing the courthouse, the roads go to the left, I think, and the right, actually. Maybe that's the other road. It says one of the streets went to the Hill Valley train station. Okay, and the other one, and the construction of the courthouse, blah, blah, blah. Most of the surrounding countryside was mountains and valleys with deciduous. Ooh, look at that. It's a word. I'm reading this and the sun's in my eyes. Deciduous trees and further out desert with mesas to the north and the ravine to the southeast of town. So maybe the ravine wasn't even part of Hill Valley yet, but it becomes part of Hill Valley. They talk about bear caves, cemetery, blah, blah, blah. I want to get to the slang. No, I don't want to get to, I want to get to Hill Valley itself. Not the timeline, none of that. I want to see what's in the downtown Hill Valley. Scrolling. Did I scroll too far? Uh-oh. I want to know what's in town. Oh, maybe I went by it already. So the Courthouse Square, it says Hill Valley Courthouse. The Palace Saloon, that's the saloon that we saw. The Livery Stable, the Wells Fargo Company, the Undertaker, the Telegraph, and Marshall Strickland's office. And the Essex Theater under construction. Okay, I missed that. So the Essex Theater, now I wonder if that's the movie theater that Mayor Goldie Wilson lets turn into a porno theater in the 80s. But the Essex Theater, I got to look for that. That's the one thing I didn't notice. They talk about Coyote Pass, County Jail. No, that's, most of that is outside of the town. So it seems like I got everything. I think I got to go back to the book, but the book talks about, I think it mentions, it says Chinese Laundry. So I wonder if that is the W.J. Chang that I saw. I wonder if that was a laundry. Like, sometimes they'll build all these signs, but you just don't see them. But they're there, but maybe the camera didn't catch it. But maybe it was in the script, you know, and that's why it's in the book. There were some Asian gentlemen where I saw a couple. I remember them by the bath. That's what I remember. So I didn't know if that was considered W.J. Chang, and I didn't see that sign. But no, it just said bats and barber. What am I? Is there an airplane going by? Or is that just like the heater? Jesus. So I think I caught most of what's in 1885. I think. It is an excellent set, and I love the fact that it just feels lived in. You know, when you go to 55, everything's so clean and new, and but it feels like the 50s. In 2015, it's the future, so you can't. It just looks like, wow, that's what the future is going to be. You know, even though that was 8 years ago, wow. You know, everything's so sleek and clean and like futuristic, for lack of a better word. But the 1885, it just felt it's tough to say, but it felt realistic. You know, for a Back to the Future movie that goes in the Old West, it felt fairly realistic as far as these small buildings and everyone. Nobody's dressed like the way Doc, 55 Doc, dressed Marty. And everyone just kind of dressed more like, you know, Clint Eastwood would be when he puts a metal sheet under his jacket in a great movie, in a great freaking movie. Of course, we know that. I don't even know if I talked about the fact that Marty taking, you know, putting the, maybe I'm getting ahead of myself talking about that, but who cares? Marty putting the, taking the part of the stove, wearing it to shoot, wearing it as like a bulletproof vest is a callback right back to Back to the Future Part 2, where Biff is watching the Clint Eastwood movie. But I always think back to Dumb and Dumber, where he's like, what if he shot you in the face? You know, but maybe the gentlemanly art of the duel means you aim for the heart. I don't know. Buford just the night before was definitely aiming for Doc's head, or two nights before. Think about this. But Marty threw the pie, and the bullet still knocked Doc's hat off. So if he didn't throw the pie, now imagine if he was aiming for the heart, right? But he would have hit him in the shoulder. Then Marty throws the pie, and it deflects the gun just enough that it shoots Doc in the face and rips half his face off. Now he's alive, but he's like, I don't know if I can make it. Like half his cheeks hanging off. They bring him to the doctor. They pump him full of opium, and they're like, "We have to." And then Doc's telling him stuff. Use this. They're like, "We wouldn't use that." No, no, use it, because he knows future medicine. But he's like, has to write notes because his cheek and his jaw have been destroyed. And but then, right? All of a sudden, like his face starts to come back on its own. Like, this is amazing. How is this happening? And he goes, ha ha, remember when I went to 2015 and I had a change of blood and, you know, had all this stuff done to me? I also made sure that I had rejuvenation put in me so that he can come back with it. And then they say, well, if that's the case, why didn't you just tell me that before? You would have survived Buford's bullet. And there goes my, well, maybe it doesn't bring you back to life. If you die, you die. But if you're alive, eventually you'll heal quicker. I don't know. I'm outside by a tree, stepping in snow. Listen. And I just completely thought of that right now because I just realized that the Frisbee pie tin, the pie slinger that Clint Eastwood, Marty McFly threw, just saved Doc's life. I mean, he would have been just murdered completely, and it only moved a little, so I'm assuming he would have shot Doc right in the face. But I guess that's when you're at a party, you can shoot people in the faces. In a duel, you try to aim for the heart because that's the gentlemanly thing to do, I suppose. And I think I'm done. I think it's really nice out. So here's what's happening for the rest of my day. We're going, since my wife is still out with her back surgery, but she is starting to feel good, and she's really hoping to get back to work next week. So we're going to take a first drive today. You know, she hasn't been in the car in a couple weeks. We had to go to a doctor's office. Oh, no, she did. I took her out for a ride, but she hasn't been out in the car, I think, for a full week. So we're going to take a ride to the beach. We're going to find, it's because it's a nice day out, we're going to find a bench or something where she can sit, or she can sit in the car if it's too cold. I'm going to take my dog, our little puppy, for a walk on the beach. And then we're just going to kind of, you know, just take a nice, relaxing drive. And I think it'll be nice to do. You know, I've watched a lot of Back to the Future this week. I've watched a lot of Back to the Future this month. I've been podcasting nonstop outside of work. You know, I have
I have two weekly podcasts that are going on right now. The Mandalorian Man, where I cover every episode of Mandalorian, and Slash, where I'm covering Halloween, the Halloween movie franchise right now in season one. It's a brand new horror movie podcast, where, and that's also on our YouTube channel, fans.experts.com/YouTube, or youtube.com/@fans.experts. And that's going on, plus Marchy McFly every day. Plus, I am working on my Fine Movies, Fine Spirits show. I want to get an episode of that out today, plus an episode of that out next Friday for St. Paddy's Day. I do that podcast with some lifelong friends of mine. So it's a busy, busy time at fansnotexperts.com. April's still going to be kind of busy, but not even as close as what we're at today. And, April, I also have to bank some podcasts because I'm going to be traveling, going down to Florida to drive my mother-in-law back. That we've already come up on that again. Jesus Christmas. Oh, the time, it just keeps on a rolling. So I'm out of here. Thank you so much for listening and subscribing. Thank you so much for coming along with me on this fun ride. I know there's not a ton of you, but I appreciate every single one of you who are out there. In fact, you don't know there's not a ton of you. As far as you know, there's millions of you. But I know, and I see it, and I think I know, you know, most of the people who listen. And the fact that, you know, I'm the guy who would walk around with a video camera to make movies for nobody, just for me or for my friends. The fact that anybody's finding this is always humbling and unbelievable and exciting. And just greatly, greatly appreciated. So I'm going to go in right now and get ready to go to the beach. Even though I'm in the snow, it's not really beach weather in Massachusetts. We're going to drive to New Hampshire, Hampton Beach, New Hampshire, where there's a Hampton Beach casino. It's not a casino. It's a place where I saw bands like Tesla and Extreme. It's a concert hall, which I don't know if I have any concerts there. I love going to concerts, but I'm rambling now, and you know that means it's time to go. So we're going to the beach, but guess what? I'll be back again tomorrow to talk Back to the Future 3 and watch Back to the Future 3 for the 11th time. But until then, you can find me on Twitter and Instagram at Geek Mentality. The Facebook page is fans.experts. The website is fans.experts.com. And I'm outside so I can say it even louder. You know what comes next. Thank you, everybody. See you tomorrow. Here is my theme song. 1, 2, 3, go. This is my podcast. I made it. Geek Mentality is what I named it. And I think you should listen and subscribe. Cause I'm kinda funny and awesome. I think that I'm worth your time. And I'm kinda handsome. My mom says, please listen and please subscribe. Or listen to this episode. Fans Not Experts.